Good evening. Welcome to Salisbury University's Spring Rideout Lecture. I'm the Provost David Buchanan, and it's my pleasure to welcome you all on behalf of the lecture series by Clydedale School of Education. Tonight brings us back to our historical roots as a teacher training institution. It's quite appropriate that one of our longest continuing lecture series is the Rideout Lecture Series. And I'm now going to introduce our relatively new Dean of Education to tell us a little bit about the history of this series. Dennis?
Thank you. When I look at the program, and I look at the list of guest lecturers who have been a part of the Rideout Lecture Series, it is indeed impressive. How many of you are students in the Foundations of Education course? F210. Raise your hands. The list of people on the back of the program make an excellent at Foundations course. And if you become familiar with them and their works, you will have indeed accomplished something. And I believe that tonight's speaker is an exceptional and appropriate addition to that list. Pauline Rao is a longtime educator. She was teacher and principal of our campus school. And that is the building that is now Carruthers Hall, which is the home of the Clydedale School of Education and Professional Study. Ms. Rao, when she passed away, she left a gift to Salisbury University. And part of that gift was transformed into this lecture series that will bring speakers, renowned international speakers, to this campus to bring us thought-provoking ideas. The change from that gift into the reality of a lecture series that is organized every year in the Clydedale School was really the work of Professor Morris Bosman, who was the first Rideout professor at Salisbury University. He's not able to be here tonight, but I want to acknowledge his wife Carol, who is with us tonight. Glad that you're here. The faculty members who compose the Rideout Committee, and I'd ask them to stand as I introduce them. Dr. Douglas Ball, Carol Navarro, Nancy Galetta, and Joel Jenny. It is now my pleasure to present to you the chair of the Rideout Lecture Committee, Dr. Pat Richards, who will introduce tonight's speaker. I'm glad that you're here. This is a wonderful occasion.
Thank you, Dr. Buchanan. Thank you, Dr. Pachanicha. Before introducing our Rideout Lecture this evening, I would like to thank all the people who have contributed to making this event a success. An event like this doesn't just happen. It really is the hard work of a number of people. And I would like to publicly thank now the publications department and the public relations folks for getting the word out, duplicating services, for their very quick and excellent work, again, helping us get the word out. Catering, they are responsible for the dinner prior to this lecture, and all of you are invited to a reception in the social room after the lecture, and they have catered that event as well. The physical plant for all of the setups and the setup crew, horticulture for the plants, event services for the equipment and tech support, even last minute requests are honored so graciously by those folks, and we really appreciate it. Instructional technology, TV services, Cindy Cornish is always there for us each and every time that we do this. Shirley Idelot in the Dean's office, our students who generously volunteer their time to help us make this event a success. So thank all of years ago, those of us who are involved in teacher preparation programs here at Salisbury State University engaged in an attempt to articulate our shared beliefs and values, the guiding principle of our teacher preparation programs. After lengthy and often heated discussions, we agreed on the aphorism, a tradition of caring. Reaching consensus among so many individuals from such varied disciplines and backgrounds is always challenging, but what was so interesting about this discussion was not that the agreement was difficult to reach. We knew that a caring community was what we valued and wanted to perpetuate. Caring for our colleagues and our students was what we had in the past attended to with some success and took pride in. It was our shared vision for the future. So the debate did not center around whether a tradition of caring actually and aspirationally represented our intents and beliefs. The debate centered on how others might perceive us if we chose that particular catchphrase. How might teacher educators and teacher candidates be positioned by a tradition of caring in view of the prevalent undervaluing of caregiving and caretaking? To us, a tradition of caring means attending to student learning, scholarship, reflection, and professional collaboration and development. But regrettably, negative connotations of caring abound. Caring sounds soft, touchy, feeling. Would caring be equated with anti-intellectualism, a lack of rigor? Would it be misconstrued as giving primacy to the affective at the expense of the cognitive? The false dichotomy of the heart versus the head is a persistent notion. Would our programs and students be negatively perceived by this emphasis on caring? How would our slogan measure up to those of other teacher preparation programs also seeking national accreditation? In a profession already accorded low status, would we risk further marginalization on campus and in the larger community with this word, caring? I think our decision to affirm and continue our tradition of caring was in a small way a courageous act. It was and is right for us. We even managed to work in the word passionate in our conceptual framework. Another heated topic of debate. We were able to overcome our doubts and reservations because of the work of scholars like our speaker this evening. Nell Noddings makes it very clear that the aim of a moral life is to encounter, attend, and respond to the need for care. Care requires attention to individuals who have different needs and interests. Schools cannot merely exist to provide academic resources. Schools, she tells us, should be involved in helping children learn how to care and be cared for. Society might reduce violence and alienation, so characteristic in life in the United States today, by caring more effectively for its children. Professor Noddings, you have our sincere thanks for articulating so cogently and powerfully the need for an ethic of care. Your work has informed and supports our conceptual framework. We are delighted to have you here this evening. Please join me in welcoming Nell Noddings.
Thanks very much. I'm delighted to be here with you, although I suspect that my good friend Alfie Cohn, who was here last year or the year before, might suspect that this is a captive audience. That's okay. I'm trying to make it as little painful as possible. I want to talk to you tonight a little bit about character education and what I regard as an alternative to it. Certainly, character education is the oldest form of moral education around. It's the biblical form, really, of moral education. And at the beginning of the 20th century, time on the board, the presidents of Stanford and Berkeley. Great minds. They're on this board together and obviously consider character education to be enormously important. But what did it look like in those days? The idea was that you would inculcate the virtues. That was the idea. And in fact, character lessons lists 31 virtues. And when you have the 31 virtues, you automatically have character. So that's the idea. And these are arranged so that you can teach three or four virtues in kindergarten, and three or four in first grade, and three or four the next year, and so forth. Now, does this begin to sound familiar? We actually have schools in the country who are doing the same thing now, trying to teach the virtues, more or less one by one, or two by two. And so, in a given week in October, we'll be studying honesty. Okay? And when everybody's got that, then we'll go on to the next one. Now, I don't mean to make it sound too silly, although in some places it is kind of silly and is operating in almost the way I've just described it. It doesn't seem to me that we learn virtues that way, nor is that the whole story when we're thinking about moral education. Well, somewhere around the middle of the 20th century, character education fell away. It fell away because there had been some very powerful studies back around 1930 that showed that it really didn't work well. That kids who went through a system like this were very, very good when adults were watching them, but not very good when adults were not watching them. So we would say, in the language of today, they hadn't internalized these virtues. It was another reason why character education fell away, I think. Somewhere in the second half of the 20th century, we began to put a tremendous emphasis on science and math education. This happened right after Sputnik in 1957, when we were actually afraid in this country that the Russians were getting ahead of us in space and technology. And so there was this tremendous effort to revive science and math education and get ahead with them. So what fits with that when you think about moral education? Well, what fits very nicely with it is cognitive developmentalism. Because now you're going to put an emphasis on reasoning, you see. And that fits very nicely with math and science. So we had a couple decades there where school people were primarily interested in Colbertian programs of reasoning, moral reasoning. Then that didn't seem to work too well either. And there is a problem with that. See, I'm a staunch advocate of reasoning. I'm an old math teacher. I taught math. Don't leave now just because I said I'm a math teacher. Because there won't be any math lessons tonight. But being an old math teacher, of course I'm interested in logic and reasoning. But here's the question. And this bothered Larry Kohler for the last 10 years of this life, I know a lot. And the question is, what's the connection between moral reasoning and moral behavior? Well, there's got to be some connection, but it isn't an obvious one. And there are people who can reason at very, very high levels and go out and do really rotten things. You may even know some of them. So, now, since that didn't seem to work, that is, we didn't seem to get a whole lot better behavior on the part of our school children with that program. Now we have this revival of character education. And so I want to raise a few questions about character education tonight. When I look at this list of 31 virtues, I'm not going to read the whole thing to you, but what do you suppose the very first one was? Anybody want to take a guess? What's the very first virtue you want kids to have? Anybody want to guess? What? The very first one was obedience. Obedience. See? Now, there may be educators today who want that, but the climate isn't quite right to say it, so you have to use some other word instead. But these folks weren't afraid to say it. That was the very first one, obedience. And then they went on to honesty and truthfulness and courage and perseverance and a number of others. we must have some criteria by which we judge whether the so-called virtuous act is indeed virtuous. And that's where I think the ethic of care helps a lot. We would not be likely to regard an act as virtuous if it does harm to another. Nor would we like it to cause unnecessary pain. These would raise questions about whether the act is virtuous. At its very best, we would like the act to respond in some positive way to the other, to the cared for. Now, we can't always do what the cared for wants us to do, because sometimes that person wants something that we regard as bad. And so we certainly can't. If someone comes along and says, well, I'd like to establish an Auschwitz here in the U.S., we're going to say no. Clearly, we're going to say no to that. But even when we have to say no, in cases that are not quite that bad, we try to maintain or sustain the caring relation by listening. That's it, by attending. That's right, by listening, by responding, by not deciding ahead of time what's good for the other, but listening to what I call expressed needs, not just inferred needs. Now, let me quickly say a little bit about that. I'm going to talk tomorrow morning more about that. Expressed needs are the needs that arise within the one who has the need, either verbally or through body language or whatever. The need arises internally. Inferred needs, in contrast, arise externally. Someone else decides that you have a need and imposes that need on you. Now, almost everything you do in school is a response to inferred needs. Even making the kids go to school. Very few kids say, oh, gee, I want to go to school. They do when they're little teeny-weeny kids. But as soon as they get a dose of it, a couple of years, then it's no longer an express need. Going to the dentist is rarely an express need. It's an inferred need. You can take your child to the dentist. And you can come up with a long list of inferred needs. That can get so out of hand that we don't even hear the expressed need. And so fundamental to the ethic of care is this balance, an exquisite balance between expressed needs and inferred needs. And we always question ourselves when we say, so-and-so has a need for, back off and think about it for a minute. Maybe the need is real. Maybe it isn't. All right, so that's the sort of background that we'll use now to look at these four virtues. And the very first one is honesty. Now, is honesty always a virtue? That's the first question. Well, if we're talking about truthfulness, I don't think it is always a virtue. And it's probably the very first virtue that we can complicate a little bit for children. The idea here is that as kids get older, we can make this whole discussion as complex as it really ought to be. With real little kids, you can't do a lot of what I'm going to talk about tonight. But in honesty, I think you can. I use the example of Aunt Hilda's dress. Suppose Aunt Hilda comes in a ghastly dress, but it's brand new, and she says, "How do you like my dress?" And a little kid says, "Oh, God, it makes you look fat." Well, you know, and mother gently takes the child aside and says, "No, you know, you hurt Aunt Hilda's feelings." And the child says, "Well, you've told me always to be honest, to be truthful." And so I was truthful. So we find that being truthful is not always virtuous. And certainly using the criteria that we developed in the ethic of care, honesty is not always a virtue. As kids get older, we can really complicate the whole discussion of honesty. And here I would refer you to Cicely Bock's book, Lying, which is just wonderful. I mean, by the time you finish reading that, you know that the vast majority of us are not really as truthful as we might be, and that there are some good reasons for it. You can't imagine, for example, being your enemies, if you have any enemies, right? I mean, you never heard of a general of an opposing army calling another one up and saying, I hear that you're going to attack on Beach A. And the other general said, oh, yes, I cannot tell a lie. We don't do this. This is ridiculous. And as kids get older, we can also talk to them about royal lies. You know what a royal lie is? So why told for the benefit of the people, because the people are not strong enough or wise enough to hear the truth. So we tell them about a royal lie. And they should hear about some of the sneakiness of the church as well, and the thing called the mental reservation, where you can live a verbal lie as long as you have a mental reservation where you're really telling the truth inside. All of that is to complicate matters in something that on the surface looks so simple, honesty and truth telling. And at the very end, when we get to the virtue of loyalty, I'm going to come back to honesty and talk a little bit about cheating and honor codes and that sort of thing, because all of us as educators are interested in these things. Oh, that reminds me of a sort of testing story that I just have to tell you, and then we'll continue to more serious things. There's this story told about two young men, who applied for a job, and they were finalists for the job, and as finalists, they had to take a test. So they took the test, and at the end of it, one fellow was offered the job. Let's say it was Joe was offered the job, and Bob did not get the job. So Bob was angry about this, and he said, how come? Tell me why I didn't get the job. And the employer said, well, it's true that you got the same grade on the test. You both only missed one question. Well, says Bob, well, then, how come? And he said, well, it isn't the score on the test, it's the way you answered. And Bob says, well, what do you mean? And the lawyer said, well, you both got number 6 wrong. And Joe said, his answer to number 6 was, I don't know. And your answer was, neither do I. A clear case of dishonesty. Clear case. All right, we'll go on to the more serious virtue here, and that's courage. Courage was named as one of the 4 primary virtues all the way back in the days of the Greeks. It has long been associated with warriors. I mean, the courage of a warrior has colored our whole view of what courage means. And now I'm going to ask the question again, is courage always virtuous? This question has been very lively since the attack on September 11th. There were people who immediately after that attack wanted to say that the Jews who committed suicide to perform these dreadful acts, and the young people who continued to do that in the Israel and Palestine, did not deserve credit for being courageous. These were not courageous acts. I don't see how we can deny them courage. It takes courage to kill yourself when you're not in despair. When you're doing it for a cause. We certainly can't say that your acts were foolhardy because they don't expect to live through it. The disciples are like, oh, I better buy it. They don't think that. They know they're going to die, so they're not foolhardy. In fact, the only thing you can do to cushion this a little bit is what the Greeks did. And that is to say, well, courage has to be accompanied by wisdom. And we don't seem to have wisdom here. But then, there are many people, and probably a good many right here in this audience, who who feel that faith is the very highest form of wisdom. Well, then what do you do? So I think we have to say that these people are exhibiting courage. I don't see any way around that. But with the lens that I mentioned in the beginning, the ethic of care, we see that we've got a way to block that. You know, grant the courage, but that sort of courage is not virtuous because it does harm the rest of people. Now we come to some sticky things. Does this cast doubt on the whole notion of military courage? Well, I think it does. And I think now, especially, we're in a period of history, a tough, tough time, and you really need to think these things through. And those of you who are already teaching may find yourselves in a position where you have to talk to kids about this, high school kids in particular. We don't want to deny the courage of those who serve in the military. Neither do we want to overdo that and suppose that everyone who serves in the military acts out of courage. Here's one kind of question to ask. If you look at wars over a long period of time, over centuries and centuries, because we haven't cured ourselves of this way of behaving, and see how young men were affected when they had to go into battle, you might raise this question. Did they go into battle out of courage or out of a deeper terror of something else? And over and over again, if you look at biographical stories and out of fiction, you find that many, many young men went into battle because they were terrified of being called cowards. They were terrified of returning home and not being accepted, of being accused, put down, given the white feather by their companions. So, courage or terror? In any case, it has to be faced. Now, a careful examination of this, and this is the hardest one that I'm going to tackle tonight, this whole courage. A careful examination of this suggests strongly to me that we do a very, very poor job of preparing young people for what faces them after high school. In fact, I would come right out and say we do a lousy job of it. 90% of the young people in our military service are people who have not gone to college, who are right out of high school. We do virtually nothing to prepare them for what might happen to them. We don't mean for how they may be hurt. That's terrible enough. They know that. But to some, that's even an attraction because it shows that they've got guts and got courage. What I'm talking about is the possible loss of moral resources. This is so well documented. I've been reading scads of books on this over the last few years. It is so well documented that when a young person goes into the military and actually has to engage in battle, has to be part of a war, he may lose all of his moral resources and do things that are so terrible that he finds it difficult to live with himself for years after. This is a very serious and terrible thing. Read the accounts of the Vietnam War. Read Jonathan Glover's wonderful book entitled Humanity, A Moral History in the 20th Century, and see what people have done in wartime. Not just the other guys, mind you, our kids. Boys who are our neighbors, boys who are our sons and grandsons. As far as Vietnam veterans are concerned, many of them have found it almost impossible to adjust to civilian life, become drug addicts, alcoholics, homeless, it isn't so much what they went through, although that was bad enough. It's what they did. Because you're sending good kids, good young people out there with no sense of what might happen to them from a moral perspective. Lots of sense of what might happen to them from a physical perspective, but no sense of what might happen to them from a moral perspective. And yet this stuff is available. It's out there. How about this, for example? This is a little bit from the Iliad. We like kids to read the Iliad as great literature, but do you remember the section in which Achilles encounters one of the sons of Priam? Do you remember that section? And this is a young prince, the son of Priam, on his knees in front of Achilles, and he's more or less begging for his life. And he says, yet one thing will I tell thee, and do thou lay this apart. Slay me not, since I am not of the same mother as Hector, who slew thy comrade. And then what does Achilles say to me? It says, fond fool, prefer me no ransom, nor these words. Until Patroclus met his fated day, then was it welcome to my soul to spare the men of Troy. And he goes on to say how many he did spare. Of course, he sold them to slavery, but he did. He did spare them. He says, but now, there is none shall escape death. None shall escape death. And he goes on, raving about that, and more or less asks the young man why he's upset about it. Why should you lament? We're all facing it. And so then he does. Slay him. Chuck him with his sword. And not only does he do that, and watching, lying there, bleeding to death, he then picks him up and throws him in the river and says, there, lie thou among the fishes, which shall lick off thy wounds' blood heedlessly, nor shall thy mother lay thee on the bed and mourn for thee. And he continues in that vein. And at the end of it, he says, for all this yet shall ye die the death until ye pay all for Patroclus slain. You see what's involved there? The emotion that has occurred there. My friend, Patroclus, somebody on the other side killed him. And therefore, everybody I knew will suffer for it. I use this example because, as Pat mentioned before, people sometimes think that the ethic of care is anti-intellectual or reader or whatnot. And so with every group to whom I speak, I try to show that, look, there's plenty of intellectual stuff there if you want to introduce it. Here we have the Iliad. And then it surely reminds us if we're not reading this to understand metaphor and vocabulary and techniques of writing. Sure, that's all fine. But you have to stop when you come to the moral lesson. Spend some time on it and think about it. And how would you follow up with high school kids, at least, or college kids on the Iliad? Well, there's a wonderful essay by Simone Weil called The Poem of Horace. And it's a careful study of the Iliad. Sometimes it's translated as The Poem of Might. It's the same essay. It's a careful study of the Iliad from the perspective I'm talking about now. What happens to people in the heat of battle and when they suffer? So you have an opportunity to do an essay by Simone today, and perhaps to talk a little about her life, too, and what she gave up in order to protest the dreadful things that were going on in World War II. And as soon as I wrote that down, it reminded me of still another thing. The book by May Sarton called The Small Room, you know that one? All those of you who are now teachers or will be teachers who certainly read May Sarton's The Small Room, because it too has the story of a young teacher, a young college teacher, who is determined that her classes are going to be rigorous intellectually, and she is not going to get caught in the trap of caring personally for her students. Remember that story? She's very careful not going to get into that trap. But as the year goes on, she does go into that. She realizes that to teach well, she has to care convinced of it, because we've had loads and loads of people in this world who were highly educated with respect to literature and who never caught the moral lesson. And we have to face that. And here I would suggest to you Virginia Woolf's book, Three Guineas, in which she discusses this with great care. She's absolutely convinced that if we looked internationally, if we looked at music and art and literature, we would see that there are wonderful things in all cultures. And how could we fight these people? How could we do that? And she's writing after World War I, with World War II looming on the horizon. And she's begging us to look at the effects of literature and even of the visual arts. And here we go again. See, just recently, was a terrific article by Susan Sontag in the New Yorker, a long essay entitled Looking at War. And what Sontag does in that is to show many of the photographs and artworks depicting war that were supposed to so revolt us, so repulse us, that we'd get over it. And she looks at the various reactions to these. And unfortunately, what seems to be the case is that what repels and disgusts me may excite someone else. So it's not a sure thing. And I don't think it's an accident that twice in the last few months they have managed to cover over their account in the viewing polls. The first time they said they were doing it because they wanted to take photo shots and they needed a plain background, so they had a blue thing over there. Second one, just the other day, they decided to meet in the basement where that wouldn't show up. Now, totally accidental? My God, it's totally accidental. Oh, so, that's a pretty grim look at one virtue, but I think enormously important. And I took through high school social studies books, looked through a heap of them. This topic, the psychology of war, and what may happen, not to your body, but to what might be called the soul, the moral self, is simply not discussed. Okay. On a slightly, but not completely, lighter tone, let's look at perseverance. Perseverance is listed in that 1909 book. We've got it all over our schoolrooms now. In fact, Tom McCona, whose book, Educating for Character, you might want to take a look at, praises a teacher, a first grade teacher, who has a banner on the front of the room that says, always do your best in everything. Okay? I think that's very bad advice. Very bad. In fact, I think it's a sure road to mediocrity. Now, for those of you who are students, listen up on this. I'm going to take this back to some of your teachers. For years, I have told my graduate students that this is very bad advice. Don't do your best in everything. You have to do an adequate job on everything we force you into. An adequate job. Save your best for the thing you're passionate about. That's where you should use your best. Save your energies. Do an adequate job, but save your energy for the thing that you're really passionate about. You try to just do your best in everything. As I said before, it is a sure road to mediocrity. Now be honest with yourself. Do you do your best in everything? When you have to clean the house, you always do your best. When you have to cook dinner, you always do your best. Did you always do your best in everything in school? Well, if you did, then you were grade rubber. Grade. And the schools are loaded with grade rubbers now. Kids who want A's. They take advanced placement courses because not only do they get A's, but they get extra tidbits on their grade point average. You can get better than a 4.0 by taking lots of advanced placement courses. and you do even better if you're very careful not to learn very much. Just do what you need to do to get an A. Now here is a little bit from a separate piece. You know John Knowles wrote a separate piece? Practically everybody in high school has to read a separate piece sometime or other. And you need to read it right now. But here we have the protagonist, the person who's telling the story, Gene, who has decided that he is going to be valedictorian. He's going to get the best possible grades. And after a while, he's doing so well that he has only one rival. The rival's name is Chet. Now here's Gene talking. He says, but I began to see that Chet was weakened by the very genuineness of his learning, his interest in learning. When we read Candide, it opened up a new way of looking at the world to Chet. And he continued hungrily reading Voltaire in French, while the rest of the class went on to other people. He was vulnerable there, because to me, they were all pretty much alike. Voltaire and Voltaire, and the laws of motion and the Magna Carta, the pathetic fallacy and testing the d'Urbervilles, and I work indiscriminately on all of them. Now, just last year, one of our former students, Stanford former student, Denise Clark Pope, published a book called Doing School, and I recommend it to you. It came out with Yale University Press, and there we have a sort of up to the minute set of case studies, very like the fiction that we just talked about, where kids see, we're sort of talking the other end of the academic problem now, not the problem of kids failing standardized tests and being left behind and not getting diplomas. We've got huge problems there. We've got problems on the other end, too. And what this quote shows is how keen those problems are. One kid she studied was, like Jean, in the second piece, doing her best to get the best possible grade in everything. She even joined clubs and sports, not because she was interested in the clubs or sports, but because she wanted lots of good things on her transcript. So it was nose to grindstone through all 4 years of high school. She even, with other information from her best friends, if she thought that would give her an advantage on the test. She had stomach aches all the time, you know, dyspepsia. She was sick a lot of the time. And so the researcher asked her, what about having some fun? What about being happy? And she said, when I get to the college I want to get into, I'll be happy. Well, she applied to all the Ivy League schools. She did not get into Harvard, which was something of a heartache, but she got into Princeton, not bad, right? So the researcher visited her on the Princeton campus. And guess what? She was now preparing for medical school, doing the same thing that she did in high school. And the researcher said, but when are you going to be happy? So I said, well, when I get into medical school. Now, what do you suppose will happen to her when she gets into medical school? I mean, you can just see the whole training of events. The supposed virtue that we're talking about here is perseverance. Now, in this 1909 book, there's something kind of wise about it. I mean, most of it you'd sort of laugh at. It's very old-fashioned. Well, here there was a couple lines from Frances Willard, and she said something very, very interesting that we should pay more attention to today. She said to kids, yeah, persevere, but persevere in your specialty, in that thing that satisfies you most and gives the most satisfaction to others. Now see, that's right out of the method of care, it really is, because it says care for yourself and care for others. Don't choose as a specialty something that's going to hurt others, for sure, but choose that thing that you can do best for yourself and for others. But that isn't the message that we're giving to kids now. We're saying, always do first graders. And then what do we do at the same time that we say that? Then we begin to grade them, give them marks. Always do your best in everything. Now what happens to a little kid who does his best in everything, and by sixth grade has got nothing but C's? See, it isn't surprising to me that it's at middle school that many of our kids begin to turn off in time. They have already by middle school. Always do your best in everything, but your best is only worth a C. What does that mean? And I'll leave that with you to think about. I am not a strong advocate of grading. You probably have guessed that already. And fortunately, all my years at Stanford, I didn't have to give grades. I didn't know that. My first couple years there, I found it out that I didn't have to give grades. That in fact, I could use something called instructor's option, pass no credit. And that appears on the transcript with a different designation from the student's option, pass no credit. So no one can say, well, you're a lazy student who just took things pass no credit. No, it was the instructor's option. The student didn't have any choice. When you start doing something like that, then people say, well, then you have no standards, right? No standards. Well, is there any other way to have standards other than giving grades? When I send an article off to a journal for publication, it doesn't come back to me marked A, B, C, or F. It comes back with suggestions, some constructive, some not constructive, but that's, then there's a little more work to do. Well, that's what I've done with my students. I ask them to write papers with me, and sometimes they have to do them all again three or four times. You want the best possible work, but you don't really have to do grades. And what do I do as a math teacher? I let kids take tests over again. In this culture, we are so used to grading and competitiveness that when you announce to a class that you're doing this, you may actually get a protest. The first time I decided to do this in a geometry class, when I said to kids, look, some of you will want to take the test over again, so you can take it over again. Now, not the very same test, of course. It could be an equivalent form, which makes more work for the teacher. But, yes, you can take it over again. And then another kid said, and what do we get if you take it over again? I said, what do you mean what we get? You get whatever you get on it. That's not fair, said the teacher. Because you mean to tell me that a person who gets a 95 on the second try is as good as a person who got 92 on the first try? Wait a minute. I said, yeah, that's what I'm telling you. Because we stand here year after year as teachers and say, what's important is learning this stuff, right? Learning this stuff. Not beating everybody else out, doing better than it, but learning it. And so I took myself to task as a math teacher. I said, yeah, I've been saying this for years. Do you mean it? The important thing is to learn this stuff? Well, then, they should be learning. Should there be a penalty for taking the test twice or twice or however many times? No. I said, no. What? Did the entire faculty agree with me on this? Other members of the math department? No. Some of them, this is what they say. And this will sound very familiar to you. I said, some kids deserve a second chance. They didn't want to finish the sentence, but the rest of the sentence would be, and some kids don't, right? Deserve a second chance. Well, see, that's when you circle back again and say, what is it I'm doing? What am I trying to do? Am I trying to teach some kind of nose to the grindstone lesson, or do I really want to learn? I'll take a chance that a kid doesn't really deserve to have a second chance. And look at two times, three times. You come to the end of the marking period and you're done for, right? Because that's the way schools are set up. But at least we can do that. But I want to leave in your minds on this perseverance thing is. There's a lot of stuff there that and that is the clause that comes after, I promise not to cheat. See, you have to agree with their article, I will not cheat or do any of these bad things, and I will report those who do. That's the benefit. That's the benefit. See, now we've put young people into a catch-22 position. Because they want to be loyal to their parents. And rightly so. I'm on their side on this. I wouldn't ask kids to report other kids. I think that's just not the way to go. What we really need to do when we set up an honor code is to talk about it. And this is a conversation that the former president of Stanford, Gerhard Casper, and I had a number of times. You can't just have an honor code, have people sign it, and that everything's now fine. I mean, people who would sign away their first parent to get into Stanford or Harvard. That would be silent. And we know that. You have to talk about it. You have to keep talking about it. What does it mean to us to live in a climate where we agree not to cheat, where we agree not to engage in any form of terrorism? How important is it? And it's probably the single most important academic virtue that comes from us. I mean, it is the foundation for academic life. So it really is important. But don't mess it up with that other clause, that one that makes people choose between the honor code and loyalty. Well, here, a wonderful unit for middle school or high school would be one on friendship. You could spend several weeks on the literature of friendship. Go back to Aristotle and see what Aristotle said about friends. A friend is one who wants the best for the other's sake. Right? So I want the best for you for your sake, not for my sake. That is the essence of friendship. And then Aristotle says friends point each other upward and make us into better people. So see what a neat conversation you could have around honor codes. If you see your friend or your colleague cheating, talk to the friend or colleague. Say, hey, you know, you're undermining what we stand for here. Don't do it. Don't do it. And there's even the possibility that a student can go to the professor and say, oh, there's been some cheating going on. Don't say who, on what date, but you let them know so we can watch a little more carefully. And so that on campuses, where you know where we have honor codes, professors are not allowed to be in the room during exams. These are unpopular entirely because we've got an honor code. But if a student says to a professor, we've got problems, then the professor can show up and say, look, I'm not supposed to be here because we've agreed we've got an honor code. But I'm here to protect you, to assure you that nothing will be going on to go on. So there are ways of handling this. In the state where I'm living now, in New Jersey, the state police advertise regularly, and it's made me so mad that I'm always ready to write a letter to the editor, but I'm going to finish the story and see why I haven't so far. A fairly big ad, and the ad is report the growing of marijuana inside or outside, a reward up to, I think it's up to $1,000. I mean, usually you get less than that. Now, what's that encouraging? You might say, well, it's the village is stamping out marijuana. And I don't think so. I mean, I spent almost 30 years on the Stanford campus. I can tell you that is not what it will do. There was a time when you could sit in the stands on the student side of the playing field or the football game and get a free hot because you're sitting in a cloud. That's neither here nor there. I'm not advocating it, mind you. I'm just saying what the truth of the matter is. But what is this encouraging? It's encouraging neighbors to turn one another in. child and do it or install it. That I would report. But this, do it and do it for money. Now, why haven't I written a letter to the editor, since I write letters to the editor regularly? Well, I haven't because I do not grow marijuana. But I do have 200 or more houseplants. I've got a greenhouse, you know, and of course, I don't think I can write this particular letter. Someone else can write this. I'll have the state police there examining all of my plants to see whether they're marijuana. Well, get the main point that I'm talking about here. When we ask the question, are the virtues always virtues? The answer is no. Those things that are named as virtues are not always virtues, because sometimes acting on them causes harm, sometimes it causes unnecessary pain, sometimes it fails to respond to the expressed need of the other. And when that's the case, I could not very well call the act virtuous. So you see how we have to complicate it. If you're going to use character education, or use some form of moral education, as the kids get older, you make things more and more complicated, more like real life, so that they see all sides of it. In one of George Orwell's essays, it's his essay, in fact, on his early schooling. The title of the essay is Such Were the Joys. And it's a very odd title, since his early schooling is not very joyful. In it, one of the saddest lines I have ever come across about education runs something like this. He says, "The abiding lesson of my boyhood was that I was living in a world in which it was impossible to be good. The world was too terrible, and I was too wicked. Impossible to be good." You see, what the ethic of care is trying to promote is a world in which it is both possible and desirable to be good. I'm going to stop here so we can ask some questions. That is the question, isn't it? That's sort of the bottom line question. five strength lessons. You don't teach them the way you teach algebra or spelling. But you teach them on the spot when an incident occurs. In Martin Hoffman's book on, I forgot the title of it, but it's on moral education, moral development. He talks about something he calls inductions. And he says that good parents of young children use this technique all the time. Something happens. And the example I use, because I love pets and because I have a lot of kids, small child picks the cat up by the tail or does something of that sort. And you say, oh, no, stop, that's wrong. See, that's the first thing. That's wrong. It's wrong because it hurts. And you explain why it's wrong. It hurts. Now that's what Hoffman calls the induction. I add a step to that. If you read the book on moral education, you'll see that I really regard the added step as super important. Then you show the child how to do it right. See, you don't just say that's wrong, that hurts, but you say, here's the way, and you know how to do that. Then you sit down with the child and you say, oh, kitty, and you show, you stroke the fur this way, not that way, you know, and you feel the silky ears, but you don't pinch them, and so forth. It requires time, and it requires attentiveness. It means that in the classroom, you're willing to stop the math lesson or the science lesson if something, some social or moral event occurs, and you talk about it. This is so important. And some years ago, I did work with the Quakers. They were putting together a new program in moral education at this great level. And what impressed me about the Quaker schools was that teachers were expected to stop the academic lesson if a moral or social problem occurred. It was just the opposite of what was going on in the public schools at the time, where many teachers were being told, never stop the lesson. Keep it going. Keep it going. Never mind. And that was when people were using assertive discipline. You know, kid does something bad, you write his name on the board. You don't talk about what it was or why he did it. Nope, write his name on the board. Does something again, an X goes next to it. Third time he's executed or something. You know, something terrible. But nowhere along the line do you let that little viper get in the way of the lesson. Well, maybe what that kid needs more than anything is to talk about what he did and why he did it and why he shouldn't do it. So that's just moral education is just, it just isn't real simple. You don't say, all right, now we've got 2 weeks to learn honesty, and at the end of those 2 weeks will be a test on, and then we're going to go on with the perseverance. You've got to be on your toes. I hope that helps. It's not a whole answer, but it's the beginnings of it.
I really want to know, do you really think that that type of teaching is going on today? That you just mentioned, that classroom academics has stopped, and the class is learning from the experience that was disassociated with the academic activity? Usually happens is a student gets sent to the principal's office, class doesn't learn anything.
Do I think that what I would like to see going on is going on? That's what you're asking. No. In a few places, stubborn, courageous people are doing it. But for the most part, teachers are discouraged from doing it. All that seems to matter is the scores on the standardized tests. And I think we're doing a dreadful, dreadful thing to our kids and to our teachers. I go all over the country talking with people, and one of the most disheartening things I hear over and over again is that some of our best teachers, typically women in their 50s who are at the top of their form, are taking early retirement because they can't stand what's going on in school. They can't stand concentrating on tests. There are cases now where they're fighting to hold on to music and art, things that are the foundation of the culture. And they have to fight to hang on to it. And then we've got this thing, no maintain them in grade, even though we know that's harmful. It's one of the few things in educational research we know almost certain. If you keep a kid back for a year, he's going to be worse, not better. Now, are there exceptions? Yes, every time I say this to an audience, I meet at least one person who's left back in fourth grade, and it did me good, you know? So, okay, that can happen. But by and large, we know that it's very, very bad, and it's humiliating. It just doesn't help. And we have kids who aren't getting high school diplomas. And this is No Child Left Behind. No, but you see, we've got to hang in there. We've got to, you know, from the stories I told and the references I gave, that I am not advocating giving up on intellectual life, that's for sure. I mean, it's too important and too vital for me to ever consider doing that. But there are all kinds of ways of getting at that. And if you attend to the business of establishing relations of care and trust, everything else goes better. Everything else goes better. One more story along that line. Some years ago, it was in geometry, where I said to the kids one day, I said, for the next 2 weeks, maybe 2.5 weeks, we're going to be doing some pretty boring stuff. It's, you know, really, they're going to be simplifying radicals, taking square roots, and I want you to learn squares of all the numbers from 1 to 25, and we'll have a quiz on it. You can all get 100 because you know exactly what you're going to ask. One kid right away said, "Are you going to ask them in order?" I'm not going to ask them in order. I had to learn them. I just this and still get 100. And I said, "Now the reason for this 2 weeks of simplifying radicals and taking square roots and doing all this stuff is that we're coming up to the world's greatest theorem, Pythagorean theorem." And when you get there, you'll be able to do all these wonderful problems because you'll have the routines now. You wouldn't have to think about the routines. You'll be liberated to do the really interesting work. And I will never forget, never, what one kid said. First there was silence in the room. And finally one kid said, "Okay, if you say so. If you say so." So it does pay off. You establish those relations of care and trust. Everything else goes better. It isn't an extra added on thing. It's the foundation of what we're doing.
Hello.
Give them something from C.S. Lewis to read, and then I so the kids will realize that there have been very beautiful things done within, say, Christian faith, but that there are many, many good people who have been atheists and agnostics. And many of our schools, it's just, don't understand that. No one has ever even mentioned it to them. And so they haven't had an opportunity to read the wonderful stuff on both sides of this issue. It's a terrific question. I think that is in part the reason that we get this peculiar sort of reaction to witches and sorcerers. It's fun, for goodness sake. And, well, see, that's part of the climate and education now, too. Thou shalt not have fun. Are we at the end here? Should we go off to another question, okay? Yeah, I'm sorry. Yeah.
I teach 7th grade, and I watched a teacher teach today who stopped a lesson on Anne Frank to have a discussion about President Bush's speech last night and talk with the kids about how they felt and that kind of thing. And then my students, immediately after I saw that lesson, tried it with me. And it didn't, like the lesson I saw, it fit in perfectly. And I wanted to stop, and I stopped a little bit, but it was almost as though, okay, you know, write it in your journal so that they could think about it and have a good discussion later. We've also had issues with illegal substances and that kind of thing. Would that sort of school event or life event be something to piggyback the moral character type things on?
Absolutely, sure, sure. Now, do you do this every day? No, you don't do it every day. Again, it requires some sensitivity and even artistry to know when this is a serious matter. Look, when kids seem to perk up when the teacher gets off the subject, and you've no doubt seen that, you've no doubt done it yourself as a student. Teacher gets off the subject, everybody just goes, what? Alive, right? All of a sudden. Is that because the kids are nasty little rascals who just want to get you off the subject? Well, there may be a little of that. I think the real thing, though, is that kids are dying to have adults talk to them about real things. That when an existential question comes up, and you talk about it, that they perk up because they really are interested. I mean, if all you did was shoot the breeze and talk about where you went last weekend and how you feed the dog and whatnot, the kids would turn off to that too, because they don't know what to achieve in education. So don't think that when they get you off the subject, it's always some sort of pernicious thing. Often it can be, you know, we call the teachable moment. It can be something really quite wonderful. Yes, yes.
And Patroclus, I think was his friend. That
was, right. Mm-hmm.
You know, he was talking to the son of Creon, and it seemed that the point you were making was that Achilles, in that war experience, was moving into more of a brutal rage,
right,
than actually exhibiting courage at that point.
Yes.
And being an English teacher myself, and just my personality, I always try to look for that middle road that the Greeks talked about in their philosophies. So my question would be is, would you advocate teaching, try to teach that middle way to students when those teachable moments come up? Like if you're covering a topic of honor or courage or honesty, and show how it can shift into either brutality or to cowardice, and what the difference is between the two.
Yeah, I sure would. Yeah. To read that page and a half from the Iliad and not stop and talk about what it means for the lives of people today, I think would just be a mistake. I mean, you can refer kids to all sorts of war stories that would illustrate the point and say, look, that these things happen today? Is Achilles a good man or a bad man? See, that's almost irrelevant. He could have been a very, very good man before this experience. And the same thing is true for kids who go into the military today. They go into very, very good people, and something could happen to them that would change them, turn them into people they would not want. And they need to know that. That doesn't mean they shouldn't go into the military. It doesn't mean that we deny courage. See, again, I would tell stories, hero stories, side by side with these other stories. Say, think about it. Could this happen to you? Could it possibly happen to you? I've got a whole flock of stories that I could tell there, but the time is kind of moving along here, so I would just say, you know, just remember as an English teacher that you aren't just teaching vocabulary and technique, and the difference between metaphor and analogy, dactylic hexameter, and all the rest of it. I mean, what's gripping is the moral stories here, yeah. And the drama, of course.
Many school systems throughout the past couple hundred years have introduced literature that's been controversial at different points, and often the community's response has been to request that the book be taken off the curriculum or banned. And I'm wondering, with regard to that, how would you suggest the school deal with community resistance when perhaps there is a good reason for teaching the book, the community resists?
Yeah. I don't think there's a single answer to this. A lot depends on the community you're in. If you're an administrator and knew what sort of community it was when you were hired, you may feel a greater responsibility to go along with the community. If you really feel that a book is valuable, then I think you try an educational approach. You try to explain it. I've been encouraging people all over the country to have open forums to talk about standards and standardized testing. Have people from both sides of the issue, but have open forums, invite parents in, because many of them don't really know what's going on. They think, well, higher standards is going to make our kids better somehow, and it's, in many cases, not doing that. So when you've got knowledgeable books that are being contested, I would first make an education effort. I mean, some years ago, maybe even today, there were people who wanted to ban Huckleberry Finn because of some of the language, the racist language used in it. But it's one of the most powerful anti-racist tracts ever written. So it's a matter, you have to, it's a matter of educating people, helping them understand what that book is really about. And the same is true for any number of books that have turned up on that on the banned list. I guess, again, it's the answer that comes out of the ethical care. Don't give up trying to talk with people. You've got to keep listening. Some years ago, at Stanford, when I gave a talk at the beginning of the term to people who are working in counseling and res ed. We have a big residential education program at Stanford. It's very powerful. And usually it's doctoral students who serve as residence assistants. And we have the programs that go right on in the dorms and in our houses. And at the end of the talk, one guy raised his hand and he said, I really like what you're saying. He said, but how do you talk with someone whose politics you hate? And I said, you talk about something else. You talk about something else. See, he had a responsibility to the young undergraduates he was working with. And I said, surely after a long summer, you can find something in common. I mean, maybe you both lost a pet or something. This particular age, maybe you lost a beloved grandparent. We can talk about that. Maybe you root for the same baseball team. Maybe you like the same beer. At that stage, you said, ah. But you have to keep those lines of communication open. Over the last few years, I've been on a couple of seminars. conversations with